thanks a lot for this introduction, and thanks a lot to the organizer. That's a pleasure to come here at Thessaloniki. So, just to prevent any misunderstanding, that's not going to be really a formal presentation of SonarQube, SonarLint, and even SonarCloud. My goal for today is to help you having some answers to the three fundamental questions. The first one is, what could I expect from a static analyzer? Because perhaps for some of you, you are used to rely on static analyzer to enforce, to simply enforce some coding convention. But I think you can expect far more. So I will try to convince you that you can get more out of some static analyzer. So this is the first point. The second point is, at SonarSource, we developed something like 20 different code analyzers. That's now part of our core business, to develop those analyzers. I guess most of you are tech guys, eager to know how to develop a code analyzer. So I will share with you how to develop such kind of technology. Obviously, we will do that in 20 minutes. So a lot of information we'll miss, but that will be a beginning. And the third point is how to get the most out of a static analyzer. Because I guess most of you, and that was mentioned by Adam at the beginning of the afternoon, when you start using a static analyzer, most of the time that's highly depressing. You analyze your project, you start having thousands of issues, and the first thing that you think about is to close, close the book, shut down the tool, and to forget what you saw. So I will try also to convince you that there is another way to proceed. Okay? Let's start by a little survey. Who knows SonarQube or already heard about SonarQube? So, okay, almost all the rooms, that's great. SonarLint, I don't expect. Ah, okay. So perhaps 20 persons, and SonarCloud? Ah, 2%. Great. So, for your information, SonarQube, this is a platform, indeed, that you can plug to your continuous integration system to know at any point of time what is the quality of your projects. And SonarLint, this is a way to get the same kind of information, but directly in the IDE. So, SonarLint for Eclipse, SonarLint for IntelliJ, SonarLint for Visual Studio Code, Atom, etc. So, okay, about myself, the introduction was really good, but and I'm just going to mention a few other points. The first one is that at SonarSource, I developed the first code analyzer, that was in fact the COBOL code analyzer. And believe me, when you develop such analyzer, you understand how lucky you are to be able to use a modern language like Java, C#, etc. Second point, so that was in May. I ran a marathon in a bit more than 4 hours. There is absolutely no reason to be proud of that, because to be honest, that's not so good. Nicolas can agree, that's not so good. But at the same time, to do that, it's not enough to be a lucky person. And you can only rely on your natural capabilities. The main point is definitely to train during something like 3 months, to sustain this, this effort, and to not give up. And for me, that's pretty similar to what I lived at SonarSource. We started, we founded the company 9 years ago. Nicolas can definitely confirm that we are not the smartest guys in the world. We are not at all extraordinary. We are definitely like you. And when we started to develop SonarQube, we didn't have in mind, again, a great idea to revolution our development process. That was by relying on Maven and some existing code analyzer like PMD, Checkstyle, Findbugs, to track quality issues over time. And that's it. We started from there, and then indeed we never gave up. We put a lot of effort in that adventure. And if I may give you a little very positive advice today, is don't wait to feel smart enough, or don't wait to think about the greatest idea to start building a project, or even found your own company, because otherwise that might never happen. So, the first question was, what should you expect from a static code analyzer? And I'm going to switch to Eclipse. So here I have just installed, so first of all the products that I talk about, so Sonarlin, SonarCube, and the Java code analyzer, C# code analyzer, JavaScript code analyzer, TypeScript, etc. All that is open source and free of use. So here I installed on Eclipse, Sonarlin for Eclipse, and that's it. I haven't configured anything. I have just opened one source file, and on this source file, Sonarlin spot an issue. So I'm going to read that. Change this condition, so let's say this subcondition, so that it does not always evaluate true. So imagine what should be done. What should be done is the code analyzer should evaluate this expectation local field whose value is Patrocross greater than Georgios, sorry for the pronunciation, and Georgios equal status. So there is an evaluation. The code analyzer keeps that in mind, and later here evaluate this other condition. And based on what he learned above, he knows that by definition, this condition, subcondition, is always true. And you really get this feedback on the fly because, for instance, here, I just have to change something to make the issue vanish. Okay? So, and again, here I'm talking about an open source free code analyzer, so now that's the kind of feedback that you can expect. Let's take another example. So, crazy source code, huh? That just to to have something simple to demonstrate. So, first line in this search for animal Heidi method, there is a call to this trim private method. Let's imagine that here, that the morning, I haven't taken my coffee, and I'm doing something really crazy. It's empty. Return null. Took. And again, that's just a matter of milliseconds to get this feedback that here, I'm going to get a dereference of null pointer, because by doing some interprocedural analysis, the code analyzer detects that when I'm calling the trim method, if animal is empty, a null value is returned. So by definition here, this dereference of null pointer will happen. So you can also expect code analyzer to do some interprocedural. If we are talking about our Java code analyzer, for the time being, this is limited to the scope of a source file, and the team is currently working to extend that to the overall project. Let's take another example, this one in JavaScript. So on my Eclipse instance, I haven't installed the web extension, so for Eclipse, this is a pure text, but Sonalint detects that this is a JavaScript source file. And for the JavaScript analyzer, indeed, this expression might have a value which cannot be called. Why? Because by doing some type inference, we know at the beginning that total is an integer. And inside the two nested loops, we know again that the type of total is still a number. So at the end, obviously, this function doesn't exist on the built-in JavaScript number. So again, perhaps that was a mistake. And suddenly, the issue disappears. So that was just to talk. That was just to talk about the different kind of feedback that you can get. Let's go back to the slides. Any question on those examples? Okay. So now, let's talk about static analysis. I guess we can easily agree on this definition. Static analysis mean analyzing code without executing it. Obviously, that just means to an end, and which kind of issues we can find with static analysis. We can find code smells, so code smell maintainability issues. So for instance, duplicated piece of code, code which is too complex according to the cognitive complexity or cyclomatic complexity, etc., etc. We can find some bugs, so the references of null pointer, resource leaks like memory leak in C++, GDBC connection leak in Java. As I demonstrated, some conditions, subconditions, which are always true false. And we can even find some vulnerabilities, so some SQL injection, LDAP injection, path traversal, etc. Even if in the Sonar ecosystem, we are not yet able to find such advanced vulnerabilities. And for that, you have a lot of different solutions to cover those needs. With the Sonar ecosystem, we try to provide the tooling to detect those three kind of issues. On our side, we do that on something like 20 different languages. We do focus our effort on five different languages displayed here. And just to come back to the inception creation of SonarQube. So as I said at the beginning, we started by building a kind of super quality dashboard. And at the inception, we were mainly relying on existing code analyzers. So FXCop, StyleCop for C#, PMD, CheckStyle, FindBugs for Java, ESLint for JavaScript, etc., etc. But if we take the example of Java, having to execute three different code analyzers, you can imagine that the overhead in terms of time of analysis is huge. There is an important overlap as well between those three products. The quality of the documentation is not the same. And quickly, it became our responsibility when a new Java version was released. So for instance, for Java 7, we provided the patch for CheckStyle and PMD to support Java 7. So at some point in time, we decided to write our own code analyzer. And that's where this story began. And let's go through all the different steps to write a code analyzer. Do you know what can be the first step when you write a code analyzer? Lexing and parsing. So let's say lexing. So lexical analysis. So you start by a stream of characters. And the first thing that you need to do is to split this stream of character into a list of tokens. Okay? So here that's pure English sentence, so only two things or infinite, etc., etc. And when doing this lexical analysis, you can even start by giving a type to some tokens. So for instance, here, or, am, you know that by definition, those tokens are verbs, the definite article, etc., etc. So you can start giving a try to the token. Second step, as Nicolas said, parsing. Yeah, here I was just saying that with a simple Java class, at the end of the lexical analysis, again here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, seven tokens in our list, and some tokens are known keywords that you can't use as some identifiers, and some of them are punctuators. Then you want to parse. So the name, formal name, is syntactic analysis. And to parse, you need to have something which is a grammar, describing exactly how to understand this language. So for instance, here, just by reading this piece of code, for you that's pretty natural to understand that this field declaration is nested into this this class. But for the time being, we don't have this information in this list of tokens. So that's the goal of the grammar, to transform a list of tokens into a tree. So here is just an example of a grammar to describe that. So we start at the top level by a class declaration. What is a class declaration? This is use of the class keyword, then an identifier, whatever is this identifier, and then a class body. What is a class body, etc., etc., etc. So on one side we have this list of tokens, on the other side we have a grammar, and we can generate this syntax tree. By the way, if you want to do that on your side, there is a famous open source library whose name is Antelor. Who knows Antelor? Okay. A bit more than 10% knows Antelor. So this list of tokens at the end of the parsing, you have this tree. Again, if you have any question, feel free to ask. But syntactic analysis is not enough. Because if we take this example, you're going to get a tree, but in this tree, you don't have any information to know to which declaration, for instance, this B variable refers to. So you don't know if this B refers to the method parameter or to the class field declaration. So next step, lexical analysis, syntactic analysis, third step, yes, semantic analysis, perfect. So semantic analysis, so if we take the example of, again, of a pure English statement, here, for us, that's pretty natural to understand that two things refers to the universe and human stupidity. That's the kind of relationship that we want to build with semantic analysis. The same way we want the former to refer to the universe and I to Einstein. So there is no common practice to build such a semantic analyzer. And I can't give you any link to an open source library to do that. It will be up to you to understand how to build such such analyzer. But the only thing that I can say is that when we built the semantic analyzer for Java, we discovered that in fact we didn't know so well the Java language, and that we didn't master so well Java language. So let's make a very simple quiz. We have two empty interfaces, F1, F2. And we have a class A with generic type T extending F1 and F2. And inside, declaration of a function whose name is fun, with the type F1 and the other function taking as an input parameter the generic type T. Depending on the order, the declaration order of F2 and F1, you're going to get a compilation error. The question is why? Perfect. The order of the type erasure. But with this answer, not sure that everyone is going to to understand. Do you want to elaborate a little bit? Because you're right. When did you learn the Java language specification? Because you are really close to the definition, to the real definition. Do you want to apply at Sonar Source? So, correct. And indeed, to know that, on our side, we had to read twice this Java language specification. And that's the same thing, for instance, in C++. That's even worse, obviously, in C++, JavaScript, etc., etc. And again, semantic analysis, that's not enough, because with semantic analysis, you're able to check, to spot some easy stuff. Obviously, naming convention. If we are talking about cyclomatic complexity, you will be able to compute the cyclomatic complexity. So to enforce most of the good coding practice. But, we dream to have more. Let's take a little metaphor. Let's imagine that you are in charge to improve the traffic flow at Thessaloniki. So that's your mission. If you have only a semantic analyzer, you'll be able to spot some easy stuff like making sure that you don't have a street with a no entry sign on both sides of the street. So that's great, but what you would like to get as an answer, you would like to get an answer to a question like, with my new traffic flow, is it possible, for instance, to go from one point to another one in less than 1 hour? Or am I really sure that there is no dead zone in the center? So a zone in which, again, due to the no entry signs, I'm not able to enter in. So you would like to get such kind of powerful answer. So if we close the metaphor here and go back to the analysis of source code, that means, please, analyzer, tell me if there is at least one execution pass for which I'm going to have a resource leaking. So for instance, I'm going to not close a GDBC connection. Or could you tell me if along all the execution paths, I'm going to have this Boolean expression, always true or always false, etc., etc., etc. And you'd like to get this answer, not only limited to the body of a method, but whatever is the deep of the call stack. So for that, you need to do, so here that's a very long name, you need to do a context-sensitive, path-sensitive data flow analysis. So, that's really long. So we prefer to say at Sonar Source, you are going to do some symbolic execution. So symbolically, you are going to execute the source code. And again, let's take a very basic example. So here, I'm starting by instantiating this my object. Then, in this condition, when A is true, my object is null. And later, again, here, I'm calling toString on my object. So for you, that's pretty easy. You know by definition that here we are going to get a dereference of null pointer. So we want to detect that. Let's symbolically execute this source code. We are going to at the beginning. So for the first program point, the first statement, we are going to create what we call a program state. And obviously, when I'm saying symbolically executing the code, we are not going to instantiate this object. We are going to learn something. And what we are going to learn here is the fact that my object is not null. The more we can learn while doing a symbolic execution, the more powerful the code analyzer is. So that's the first step. And then we go through this branch. So when A is false, nothing is changed, so my object is still not null. And at the opposite, when A is true, by definition, my object now is null. So now we have two program states. And we continue the execution. So let's give a try to the first program state. For the first program state, A is false. So by definition, this condition is true. We are going to enter into the branch. And as we enter into the first branch, we don't execute this second branch. So we stop the execution here. So let's give a try to the second program state. Here, A is true, so not A is false, so we don't execute the first branch, but we execute the second one, and obviously here, we are able to detect that we can get a dereference of null pointer. That's it. Any question before talking about the technical challenges when doing a symbolic execution? Okay, when we do that, we can face some important technical challenges, and that's one of them. Obviously, there is a kind of combinatorial explosion. So here, with those three simple statements, at the end, you end up with 8 different program states. So you have to symbolically execute this function foo 8 times. So obviously, if we start having a big method, you can end up with thousands of program states. But then we have some techniques to limit this explosion. So when we don't learn anything, for instance, in a branch, we are able to merge some program state to avoid this this explosion, or at least to limit it. Second technical challenges, for instance, here, I don't want you to double check what I'm going to say, but for sure, this condition is always true, when the first one is true. And for the time being, we are not able, so the Java C# code analyzer are not able to spot an issue here, because that would require to use some SMT solver to deal with such kind of advanced arithmetic expression. And the third funny challenge is that when we started doing this development, so implementing those symbolic execution for Java, C#, C++, etc., at some point in time, we were able to find some advanced bugs, but our end users were coming back to us saying, "No, you're wrong. That's not true." And that was our responsibility to demonstrate that indeed there was an issue. So when you start being able to spot such kind of advanced bugs, that's really important to provide also all the information to make it possible for a developer to replay what was done by the symbolic execution engine. So here, for instance, the different step is when MD is null, if there is an exception thrown here, catch here, nothing happened here, and by definition, there is a dereference of null pointer. So the ability to report some valuable information is really a key feature. Okay, should I? Okay, I'm not going to. Sorry. Okay, I'm not going to talk too much about interprocedural analysis. If anyone have a question about that, feel free to come back to me at the end of the presentation. So at the end, with a static analyzer. Indeed, we are analyzing code without executing it, but at the end, this is by symbolically executing all possible paths. And that's the challenge. So now let's imagine that you have such powerful code analyzer. So it can be by using SonarQube, SonarLint, or other tools. And you want to start relying on those tools. So how you should proceed? Any idea?
Analyze your code.
Yeah, that's definitely a good starting point. You should analyze your code. Perfect. So you have a project containing, for instance, 100,000 lines of code. You analyze this project, and you end up with 4,000 issues, so 4,000 code smells, bug vulnerabilities. So what should be the next step? Sorry?
Repaired issues.
Resign. Ah, yes, that's also a good option. Prioritize. And how are you going to prioritize? Frequency. So I start liking this proposal. Categorizing. So that's not so far from prioritizing. So our goal is indeed to clean the code. And we would like to do that in a very funny way, efficient way. And if it's possible, we would like that to be almost free. I guess you can't. You can only agree to that. But this is definitely hard because when you start analyzing a project, the total amount of technical debt is indeed highly depressing. Are we going? Yeah, there is a. Yeah, gamification can be definitely an option. This is something that we currently think about to add some gamification in SonarQube. So that's definitely a good idea. So some of us might ask our manager a dedicated budget to fix the technical debt. But let's imagine one second that you are this manager. Your team, they work during 3 years on the development, and this same team 3 years later come back to you saying, "We deliver something which is not so good. Please give us, I don't know, 4 months, 5 months. We are going to fix everything." Okay, so you did a bad job, and now you ask me to invest to fix all that. Are you able to swear that that's not going to happen again? Yeah, perhaps, hopefully, I don't know. So asking for a budget, and by the way, if you do believe in continuous delivery, that's simply not possible. To stop everything and just fixing some technical stuff. Okay. Moreover, that's a bit controversial. According to Nicolas, technical debt is only due to project manager. I tend to disagree, because as long as you don't have a tool able to detect the technical debt, you might not be aware that there is a technical debt. So the level of awareness can depend on the fact that there is a tool to really spot this technical debt. The other very important point is the risk to inject a functional regression. Let's imagine that you have a source file which has not been touched during the past 2 years, and there is a huge technical debt. The source file is not covered by unit test, everything is duplicated, blah, 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 blah. But at the same time, the source file has not been updated during the past 2 years. What should you do?
Nothing.
Nothing. Good. Perfect. And that's exactly what Adam said as well at the beginning of the afternoon. Because you start paying some interest only when you change something. As long as you don't change a source file, you're not paying some interest on the technical debt. So this doesn't make any sense to change, to increase the quality of a source file which has absolutely no reason to evolve. Okay? Because if you start doing that, so let's imagine the source file is not covered by unit test. Okay? So for instance, you try to remove a duplication. By doing that, you inject a functional regression. The business analyst didn't ask for anything. You go into production, there is a new bug. How are you going to explain that? So the first thing that should be done is let's forget this technical debt. That's it. Easy for the timing. So let's go directly to this water leak metaphor. Let's imagine that in your bathroom, you have a water leak. What's the first thing that you are going to do? Is it to fix the leak, or is it to mop up the water off the floor? Sorry? Switch off the water. Yeah, that's a very good point. So you switch off the water, and then? Remove the leak. So if we close the metaphor here and we go back to the management of the source code. In a source code, what is for you the leak? Yeah, but you knew that. You're not allowed to answer. So what is the leak for those who didn't listen? Sorry? No, that's not the correct answer. What is the leak? That's not what I expect to hear. Yeah? Sorry? New lines of code. Perfect. I'm sorry, I don't have any t-shirt with me, but you won a t-shirt, so... Drop me your address after this presentation, you will receive a t-shirt. New lines of code, this is the leak. This is the only thing that matters. Okay? And we should fix the leak. So the quality of any new lines of code should be high. For the existing lines of code, we can forget, this is the past. And in 2 months, when you will start updating an old source file, at that point in time, and only at that point in time, you will start remediating the quality of this source file. Okay? In terms of risk to inject a regression, think about that. You are just remediating the quality of updated source file or new source file. So by definition, you don't have to make any effort to understand what is the purpose of this of those lines of code. This is something that anyway you are currently touching. Okay? And for your manager, this is fully transparent. You don't ask anything to your manager. You don't ask for a budget. You don't ask for time. You're just saying, in fact, I think you're not going to say anything, by the way. The same way when you started to do some unit tests, you started to do some unit tests. That's it. This is not his job to do that. To be aware of the development practices that you want to put in place. And the very, very good side effect, if we take the example of Google, they claim that each year 20% of the code is updated. So we can imagine that after, I don't know, 5, 6, 7, 8 years, all the existing source code will have been touched. And so progressively, you're going to increase the quality of your overall portfolio without having to make any extra effort. Last thing, when you're using a tool like SonarQube, there is the concept of quality gate. So the same way when you use a continuous integration system, if the build fails, nothing is more important than fixing the build. That should be the same thing with code quality platform. So for instance, with SonarQube, what should be the rules to give a go or a no-go to do a release? Most of the time, this is a kind of controversial question. Is it fine to go into production without any unit test, with such amount of duplication, etc., etc., etc.? Here, when you use a tool like SonarQube, there is a built-in quality gate, and you can change the criteria. But the criteria by default are the following one: we don't accept any new bugs, so new bugs on new lines of code. No new vulnerabilities on new lines of code. The coverage on the updated lines of code should be greater than 80%. And the amount of technical depth, so I'm not going to enter too much into detail, let's say the density of code smell should be lower than 5%. And just based on those criteria, at the end you can get this go-no-go. Is it good enough or not? I don't... yeah, for you. This is my email. So to sum up, because the title of this presentation was spot new bugs, code smell vulnerabilities as fast as you could, what I would advise is you should have such kind of code analyzer integrated into your IDE, so Eclipse, IntelliJ, etc., to get this feedback really quickly. But if you miss it anyway on a pull request, you should have a way to decorate a pull request with such kind of automatic code review tool. And if you don't have this feedback directly on the pull request, let's have it at least on the master of your project and tracking all those new issues on the master of your project. That's it. Thanks a lot.